introduce in English everybody and say hello. That's very easy. I mean, I can say hello in Norway. Maybe you say hey. And hey to Norway. Hey. I have from hey to Norway. So, hello. And hey to Sweden. Also, yeah, I try. And sorry, Julie, hey to Denmark, of course. Yeah. So,
you're an opportunist.
Everybody, and I hope you can enjoy the masterclass with one of the famous trumpet player in the world, with Ole Edvard Antonsen. Thank you for your time, Ole Edvard, that you spent your time for us, for the students in Rostock, and for many students around the world now. It's very international, I see. And the masterclass will be like a question and answer game. So we take that very easy, and Ole Edvard prepared, I know, some small things to prepare, to show, and his life and the trumpet. And if you have some question about how he practicing, or how he's skiing, or how he's flying, or then please don't hesitate to ask him or to ask other people. And I wish you a very nice masterclass together with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ryan, for inviting me. And it's a great pleasure to take part in this class. Normally when I do these kind of classes, well, I haven't done many on the internet, but normally I like it when it's more like an open forum, if you understand what I mean. So people can act and react to whatever happens, maybe come with some disagreements, because for me, it's about music, it's not so much about the trumpet. And I feel, for me personally, I can live without the trumpet, but not without music. And it was just by coincidence that it happened to become the trumpet that became my instrument. So I feel, for me, it's all the work I'm doing on the instrument as the basic work, because all my practicing is 70 to 80% is basic. Because I know if I'm in good shape, I can play whatever I like. And so all the technical, physical practicing on the instrument is for me like a process of freedom away from the instrument. Because I don't like this little piece of metal to prevent me from doing the music I would like to do. So I try to be free from the instrument. And of course, we all know that the trumpet has its physical demands. So we have to practice a lot to really feel that freedom. I'm quite sure I will never get as free as I would like to be, but I'm always aiming for it anyway. So I always have that as a main goal to what I'm doing. And I think very often we are talking about so much about trumpets, about mouthpieces, about high notes, about fast, all these technical things. And of course, it's a very important part of managing the instrument. But that's just the physical skills. Everybody can practice that. But to be free from that and just see the music and adapt the music and use the instrument to perform the music, I think that's where the real skills are. For me, I just want to talk a little bit about my background. I grew up in a music family. I have my mother and my father were musicians. And I have two brothers who are also musicians. One younger brother, he's a trumpet player. He's playing all these high notes and all the pop music and jazz and recording artists, television shows, and is very, very busy. My older brother is a bass player. and he's playing in my band, my more like pop rock band. We all came together when we were quite young and had a family band playing dance music to dance in a hotel up in the mountains in Norway every holiday for 17 years. So that's how I grew up playing that kind of music. But my father always said, have the classical fundament for all the things you're doing on the instrument. So I always been practicing and performing classical music, but also always played jazz, pop music, dance music, whatever. So for me, it's always been very important to be open-minded about styles of music and try to adapt really into the different styles. But again, the instrument is just, trumpet is just an instrument to perform music. So I also try to challenge myself in terms of what's possible and what's not possible on the instrument. And I always try to not see the borders and about what's not possible. I just try, I think there are challenges which may take longer time. But still, we have, of course, some fundamentals in terms of the styles of the different music we're playing, which is, of course, important about the understanding of the different styles. I grew up in a family of musicians. I started playing the piano when I was 3 years old. When I was five, my parents moved the piano down to the basement of the house, and there it was dark. So, and I was too afraid to go down and practice. So I started, I found an old bugle in my father's dressing room, and I got quite good sound after 1 week. And then I had a cornet as my first instrument because my arms were not long enough for the trumpet. So I played a cornet the first couple of years. First time I was a soloist, I was seven. I played, there was a famous Norwegian trumpet player, was more like a popular music player. I played one of his tunes with my father's orchestra in front of 800 people. That was the first performance I had. And I don't remember much of what I played, but I remember very well that my mother had forgotten to put on my suspenders. So at the end of the piece, I was staying on stage with the trousers on my knees. My pants on my knees. So it's embarrassing at the time. But when you get away from the experience, you call it experience. So it's something you always bring with you. So the last thing I do before I go on stage is always to check the zipper and my pants. I was playing in my father's big band, jazz, the family orchestra, in the wind band, and I had the classical fundament with Arban and Clark as my first books. My father was my first teacher. He was not a trumpet player, he was a saxophone player and clarinet player. But when I became 10, I became a student of Professor Harry Kvebeck. He was very well known in Norway and in Sweden too. Fantastic personality and great musician and human being. And I think what I learned the most from him was actually about life, philosophy, religion, different things around the whole thing. But of course, he was a brilliant trumpet player. He was not always as that good to explain the technical sides of it, but he was always playing in front of me. So, and try to copy him was a very, very good school. First time I was soloist with symphony orchestra, with professional symphony orchestra, I was just turned 14. It was with a Danish orchestra in Odense. I played Arutyunyan. My younger brother played Haydn, second and third movement. And then we played a couple of duets. And in the end of the concert, we played in the orchestra, the Triumph March from Aida. So we did, that was my first experience with a professional orchestra. But then all of a sudden, from playing lead trumpet in big bands, being a soloist, doing all styles of music, all of a sudden I could not play, I couldn't produce any sound in my trumpet. I was 14 at the time. Before that, everything was very easy. But all of a sudden I could not play. So what happened was that my teacher told me, well, you probably played too much. You should just relax a week and then start over again. And that kept going. He couldn't really cope with these issues I had. So I didn't play for 1.5 years. I didn't play at all. So I was working at the local airport. I was playing football in the local team. And I was very, very frustrated because there was always a lot of music in our family and in the house. But then all of a sudden, a Swedish teacher, friend of ours, Bo Nilsson, came to my hometown to have a class. And my father asked him if he could take a lesson with me, which he did. I remember he had so busy schedule, so this was in the middle of the night. And what had happened, I can just try to show you, because when I played, I had my position on the lips and the mouthpiece was very low. So I didn't use much on my overlip, just this little red part here. So my mouthpiece slipped down like this. So I actually stopped the vibration point. And so the first lesson with Bo Nilsson, after 1.5 year without playing, we were only buzzing and repositioning the mouthpiece. Everything was just and of course, every time my mouthpiece came close to my mouth, I opened, which was a mistake. So I did. So that's why we just kept buzzing. You obviously know this line from Bo Nilsson. So we were doing this for 2 hours. And then after 2 hours, Bo Nilsson said to me, but Ole Edvard, this is no problem. You just come to me in Malmö for 10 days and we will fix this. And I remember that day very, very well because I started crying immediately because that was the first time someone told me there is no problem. Because everybody was talking about problems, about issues. So after that experience with Bo Nilsson, when he told me this is no problem, I stopped using the word problem. There are no problems. There are only challenges. And everything we do is more about challenging ourselves. Sometimes it may take a lot of time to achieve a result. But I think we should never stop believing. And we should always keep working. And after that lesson, I had to sell my piccolo trumpet to get money to go to Bo. So I went to Malmö, stayed there for 10 days. And we were just buzzing with the mouthpiece, with the instrument, 6 hours every day. And nothing happened the first 5-6 days. But all of a sudden on the 7th or 8th day, all of a sudden I could play very high notes. It sounded like Mickey Mouse, but of course, from not being able to play at all, for me, it was like, wow. So I was just basically fooling around on a horn in the third octave, like Mickey Mouse, but I didn't have the lower octave. So, but we were testing this out. And then, of course, when I start stabilizing and trying to get the deeper, the lower octave, the high notes also came down. So it was quite obvious what happened. But after being there the first time, I went home. And I was so devoted to really become a musician after being away from the music for 1.5 years. So I sat down, practiced 8 hours every day, only buzzing, and doing these exercises with James Stamp and Louis Maggio. So I practiced this for, as I said, I was, at that time, I was still in college. So I was 15 and a half. So a normal day for me at that time would be waking up in the morning. I practiced 1 hour before I went to school. And then in the lunch break at school, I had a room. They lent me a room in school so I could practice 1/2 hour. First thing I did when I came home from school was practicing 1.5 hours. Then we had dinner. I practiced 1 hour. Then I did some homework for my school and went out with some friends. And then I practiced a couple of hours at night before going to bed. So that I was doing for 1/2 year. And then I went back to Sweden, to Malmö, to learn how to relax. Because of course, when you're buzzing, it's too tense and it's you don't play that way. But it was most of all to get the vibration point on the lip sound easy and feel that it was easy. Not non-press, but easy. So after being at his place for 10 days again, I sort of get back to old issues. And then I had to get back in shape, only buzzing. And then every time I try to relax, sometimes I open too much. And this went on and off for a few years. It can still happen occasionally today. The difference is that now I know what it takes to bring it back. And it takes time and it takes hard work. So sometimes if I feel very bad, I break up the day into different parts and even stay up at night after sleeping some hours. Maybe I turn an alarm clock at 3 o'clock in the morning. I go up and practice 1 hour, go back to sleep. Just because I wanted to be in touch with the instrument as much as possible, but not for a long period, but shorter period through the whole 24 hours. Then I came into the State Academy in Oslo to study, and I did 4 years of study in 3 years. And besides studying, I was freelancing and doing studio works, jazz clubs, playing with the orchestras, symphony orchestras. I did a lot of different things. And basically freelancing beside being a student. I went out or I graduated from the school at the age of 20. And then I was asked to travel around the world as a soloist from big management. But I said no, I turned it down because I didn't see a life spending time on my own in hotel rooms all the time alone. So I was too social and wanted to do many styles of music. So I was very fortunate because there came up an open position as second trumpet in Oslo Philharmonic Orchestra. I auditioned and got the job, and that was really fantastic for me. So I was there for 8 years, from I was 20 to 28. The 2 last years I was on leave from the orchestra. So beside being in the orchestra, I was a normal day for me could be in the first person in a concert hall in the morning, practicing 1 hour. Then we had 4 hour rehearsals from 10 to 2. Then I went into the recording studio and recorded pop music from 3 to 6. And then I was playing in the cabaret theater from 7:30 to 9:30. And then I played in jazz clubs at night. that was a typical day for me for a couple of years. Then after some years, I found out I was 25, 26 maybe. I was also playing solos beside this and did a lot of different repertoire, of course. But I found out if I'm not trying to become a soloist before I turn 30, I will gonna regret at some point in my life. So I decided to go for two competitions. One was in Toulon, this was in 1987. Janne, was it 87? Yeah, I think so. So the competition in Toulon was in May that year. And there was the Geneva competition in September. So I stopped doing all freelance work. I was only playing second trumpet in the orchestra for half a year and only practiced to try to get into a solistic shape, which I feel is very different from playing jazz and different kind of physical things on the instrument. So just to try to get into a solistic physical shape, I practiced a lot. So when I went to Toulon, I had only managed to prepare first round repertoire. So I played the first round and I was quite pleased. Then I came to the second round and I had not even looked at the music, and that was a catastrophe. And maybe one of the worst decisions I made in my whole life was to decide to play the second round. I should have just said no and left, but I decided to play. And of course, the result was as expected. It went totally down the drain. So I remember Timofey Dokshitser came to me after my second round playing and he said, "If you drive a car like you play, you will be killed." It was really, really bad. And but I had a fantastic time after the second round together with Janne Gustafsson. We were in the beach during the day. We were totally sunburned and came to the evenings to listen to the finalists playing and being nervous. We were just calm and just had a really great time. And listening to the finals, it was fantastic, of course, a very high level. But I decided after doing that, this is not too scary. So I would really go all in for the competition in Geneva in September. So I decided to really practice very hard and to bring my own pianist for that competition. And the result is history. It went well. I came to the finals and won the first prize. And that was for me, actually to win the first prize for me was not so much about winning the prize or getting engagements, but it was more about building self-confidence. So for me, it was like, now I have the confidence that I can do something right. So I left the Oslo Philharmonic Orchestra. This was in 1988. And ever since that, I've been a full-time soloist classical soloist, but also in different other styles, since I had this background with all the different styles. So today I'm doing a lot of contemporary music. I'm doing classical, of course, with orchestras and with pianists and organists. But also I have my own pop band or rock band or jazz band or whatever, a combo. And I write my own music, which more and more, so which I'm doing with my band and with symphony orchestras. So it was a long speech, but a short version of my career. Any comments or questions? I can't hear you, Jörg, Rainer. You have to.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, sorry. Yeah, it was very great. Thank you for the part of your life now. And what you told us is really, really great, a way of musician. And I also told every time for my students, they have not to be only thinking about a trumpet and about a part of metal. They have to thinking about the music and the life around this music, or the music around this life. And this was very, very, very great what you told us about that. And I feel many trumpet players, they are good this way. They are like brothers or sisters in this way. And we have many ways to finding Rome, Roma. And finally, the goal is still walking.
You know, just to comment on that, I have these speeches for people, also for corporate people, sometimes talking about my career and about the ways to Rome. They say that every road leads to Rome. But are we sure about that? How about being in Rome? Every road is going out of Rome. Is Rome the real answer, or is the road to Rome more interesting? For me, sometimes when feeling that you're working so hard to achieve a goal, so you forget to see on the road what's happening. And for me personally, I like the process more than the result. So I'm very curious, and very often when you decide a direction on, for instance, studying a new piece, the first thing you do is, okay, you have an idea how you would like to do this. It's this direction. But we're not sure if that's the right direction. That's an idea we have. So what I do is that I take the initial idea. I practice very hard. So I'm totally consistent on this is how I would like to do it. Then I turn this way and I practice a total different way, which I believed was wrong. And I don't just fool around with it. I practice very hard. So I really make it the way, even though I believe it's wrong. And then again, this direction. So after doing these different things, then maybe the road that you had initially was not this way, but this way, or even like this way. And I feel to be able to be flexible in that term, it's very important, because you never know if your shape that very day, when you're playing with an orchestra, if your shape, physical shape, is really working the way you would like it to work, or you're used to working. Maybe the acoustic is totally dry and you're used to a wet room. Maybe you feel different here. Maybe the orchestra wants something else, or the conductor wants something else. Then this is not a new situation, because you've been in all the different directions, so you can be flexible. And I can tell you one story about this, because I remember this maybe 15, 20 years back. I was engaged to do a concert in Berlin at a Baroque festival. And they have, I was playing Telemann, Tartini, and a Handel piece, I think, three concerts. I arrived the day before. We had only dress rehearsal in the morning, then concert in the evening. That was the only rehearsal we had before the concert, and the concert was broadcasted. And I was playing with the Slovakische Kammerorchester. And the orchestra came by bus during night from Slovakia to Berlin. So they had been driving all night. After concert, they went on the bus back to Slovakia. So this was to save money. And of course, when we started the first rehearsal, started playing Tartini or Telemann, the style was totally, totally different from what I would like to do with Baroque music, because they played heavy and big, like if it was Brahms, you know, da-dum, da-dum, really fat and big, totally different from what all the vegetarians would accept. So I decided to, if you can beat them, join them. So I decided, okay, I have to adapt to their style of playing rather than try to turn them around. So I played bigger, more romantic in a way. And I had such a ball. It was fantastic. The concert went well. It was totally different, maybe out of style sometimes, but we had a great ball and the musicianship was there. And I was so happy. And I have no idea what the critics would say. And I didn't care because it's about music and it's about creating something. And I can accept listening to people doing things very different from what I would like them to do. But as long as people have worked really hard or you can hear that they have an idea, then I think, why not? Because it's about music and musicianship. And in music, for me, it's not one way or the other. It's many ways. And we should always take that into consideration in terms of how to approach the music. Because I think today, the media world is so different because everything is so accessible in turn from internet and from YouTube. You can listen to everything. Everything has been recorded many times and we are copying all what happens. Sometimes I feel it's more interesting to really dig into the sheet music, see how it's written and try to make my own interpretation. Because there is a system of notation, which we can come back to later on, but the system of notation is made for the composers to write the music the way they hear it, or they like us to. And then we should read the music from the same system and interpret, whatever. You know what I mean. And make that become music. But first of all, then we have to really understand how is it written? What is the meaning? We can come back to that. I think a very good example would be the Arutyunyan, which I told you, Rainer, before. But we can come back to that later. But again, back to going into Rome, all the ways going into Rome. Maybe they're going out of Rome. Who knows?
Yeah. Yes, maybe you. Moment. Can you hear me? Yeah. Yeah, that's a very nice idea. But I think also if we go to Rome or we go out of Rome, we have what you said before, many, many, many different ways. And only the way is our idea. And finally, we have a lucky day and can put some ways together, or we have not a so funny day and we're walking on a winding road alone with our trumpet and behind us the conductor hunting us, or we are try to catch the music. But it's not the masterclass that I'm talking. I think, please, if you have some question for Ole Edward, you can do that. And if it's in German, I will translate. If it's in Saxonia, I will also translate. And if it's in Danish, Julie will translate. So yeah, it's really, really, really great. And I could find one photo and you know this man.
Of course, Bo Nielsen.
Yeah, yes. Yeah. And he said, if you don't want to be a taxi driver, you should practice. every time was his last word in the class. So,
you know, I think what I think is important to remember is why, you know, I was teaching at the State Academy of Music in Oslo for 6 years, but I left. Because it was more about the academy than about music. So I found out it was not the right place for me to be. But I remember the last year I was there, we had 6 new students. I was mostly teaching the masterclass students and the diploma students, but I also had classes with the new students. And the first class I had with them, just after they just started at school, I said, I give you two tasks that I would like you to do. I want you to write down two Word documents. The first Word document, I don't want to hear you play today. I was only have these two Word documents. The first document should be about the repertoire. I would like you to write down what you have played so far. I would like you to write down what you want to play in the future. And I can fill in what I think you should play. Should be easy. Then the second Word document should be about dreams. Why did you start playing the trumpet? And what is your ultimate dream, if you can choose? It doesn't have to be a relevant dream. It just dream as high as possible. What is the ultimate dream? Is it to become solo trumpet player in Berlin Philharmonic? Is it to be a soloist? Maybe become a professor? What do I know? I have no idea. Just write down this. After 1 month, I had two answers out of six. Two students had delivered these two Word documents. I took a new class and I said, listen, this is not brain surgery. This should be very easy. Please deliver these Word documents to me. Then at Christmas time, after 3 months, 4 months, I had three answers out of, no, four out of six had delivered. There was two, they could not put down this Word document. And I find, I mean, to be honest, I was not so much into their answers. I just wanted them to think more about what are we into? Why are we doing this? What is the dream? And because if you have a dream, then it's then you have a direction of what you want to do. And then it's very easy to practice because you have the dream. If you don't have the dream, you're a little bit more lost. And to pick up that, I would like them to think more about what you want. Why are you here? And my conclusion was that two of them could not answer those questions. And I think it was because they didn't maybe think about the dreams. They didn't have the dreams. Maybe they were very good physical players in their local society, and people around them say, well, you're so talented, you should go to the academy. And then they audition for the academy, get in, and then they had already fulfilled their goal. But that's when it starts. And that's sometimes it starts, I mean, I think it's always good to sit down sometimes for everyone. I do it every now and then, every 5 years or whatever. I sit down, write down on my piece of paper like this, just some notes, maybe about what would I like to do with my life? How can I get to the different goals? And you always have to have a goal. You have to have a direction of what you want to do. Some dreams should be fulfilled, but some dreams should never be fulfilled. So it's a little bit like this carrot in front of your nose. It will always move and you will always expand. And I put down some 5 years plans every now and then. And maybe after 3 years, I pick up the plan and I see, where am I? Am I on the right way? Sometimes I've already passed my goal after 2 years, but I have already new goals. So I didn't realize I had passed the initial goals. So I think it's important for everyone to have dreams and to not forget, why did we start? For me, it started by playing like a child, like having fun, basically. And it should always be fun. But when it's not fun anymore, then comes the discipline. Then you have to be very disciplined to get around the hard times. And when you get around that, then it's like if you're in gaming, one level up. So I think this is, I think this is things I'm working on all the time, also with myself. I mean, it's not only about talent, physical talent, it's hard work. And to really work your talent to become something different, it takes a lot of work, unfortunately, but also fortunately. Because the roads to Rome are more interesting than Rome.
Very great. Thank you very much. Really, 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 really great words. It's like a Bible for the trumpet player.
I've been talking a lot. I don't know if I should I play a little video with unfortunately, I think most of it is in Norwegian, but just so we have an idea about some different things I've been doing. This is mostly things from the 90s and a little bit into 2005 or something. I can, if you have time or if you like.
Please.
This is more like a presentation video I'm using in front of some speeches I have for corporate people and things, just to show them a little bit about the variety in things I'm doing, and also about my philosophy in what I'm doing.
I have one question.
Yes, sure.
Yes. So thanks for talking to us. I was just wondering, you talked about 8-hour practice when you were very young and 80% basic work to keep you in shape and you can play everything you like. Has your practicing changed over the years? The things you practice or the time you need for certain things? And secondly, do you use some kind of a routine, or you change things in the Ray Mays 10 weeks practice schedule or something like that? Those two questions.
Well, it's a very interesting question. And yes, definitely it has changed over the years, and definitely because I'm close to 60 now, and I'm not young and talented anymore, so I have to work harder in different ways. And sometimes some things takes longer time. Sometimes some things I'm not focusing as much on as I used to do. And when I talk about basic, in the beginning of the 20s or in my 20s, I was doing much more basic in terms of James Stamp, Arban, Clark, etudes. I have not been so much into etudes like I've been playing all Charlier, Arban etudes, all these things, of course, but sometimes I feel that to play some of those etudes is so physically demanding. So very often students cannot play through the whole piece without stopping. And then why should they play all these things? Why not focus more on the music they're going to play at some point, that they're playing with an orchestra or with an organ or something, and make exercises out of that? For me, my Bible has always been Arban. And when I have time, I sit down playing the first part in Arban, and I'm playing around, having fun with it. My physical exercise or routine, it has changed also, because I try not to be too stuck in one way of doing it, because sometimes you're using so much energy and physics to only to do the warm-ups. What we're all aiming for is to have more time to play music. But of course, instead of doing all the easy keys when you warm up, why don't you take the difficult keys? For instance, I used to also when I was improvising, I always used to like the flat keys, B flat keys, best. Now I like the sharp keys more. The reason is because if you play all this open, it's like playing an open strings on a violin. Then you cannot form the note. So if you play an open note, it's not so much you can do with it. If you play with a valve, you can form the note in a different way. So I like the sharp keys much more than the open keys. So my warm-ups and my basic has changed over the years, definitely. And most of the warm-up should be precisely what it should be. It should be a warm-up. You should not kill your lip doing the warm-ups. You should build the stamina, and you should to make your lips and the muscles flexible. But to build stamina, you have to stretch. I mean, you have to start here and then stretch more and more like this. You cannot start like this. So, yeah, I don't know if that was an answer to your question.
Yes, thank you very much. A second question came up, and this is, did you ever teach children? And you were talking about it has always to be fun. And then there's always a point when children start to maybe get to the next game level, as you mentioned it. Yeah. There's much resistance. Have you any considerations how you deal with things like that? And have you special maybe tips or something for the education of the younger players?
That's I think to teach younger players is difficult because it's so hard to have the focus. But I remember, I can only tell from I have some young students which obviously have some talents and they are self-going. I remember very well when I was young and how my teacher was teaching me, because my approach to teaching is always been, I cannot teach you how to play the trumpet, but I can give you ideas about how you can become your own teacher, because all the practicing you have to do on your own. You cannot be dependent on the teacher. You have to be self-driven in a way. But for instance, taking Arban, you know all this. All these things. To make that as fun musical pieces. And you know. All through this, and I remember, for instance, this last one. If you have the book Arban, I didn't bring any music. I just have my horns here, because I'm in the cabin in the mountain. But if you take, yeah, there it is. Perfect. If you find this. This is in the beginning. If you find it in a book. I cannot hear you. I think you.
I'm sorry. This is a very old edition, like 100 years old. This one?
You just disappeared. Let me see. Oh. Where did you have it? I hear it.
Can you see it?
Yes, but it's the long one. There's one. I think it's the last one in this part, maybe.
A minute.
It goes through the whole quint circle.
Oh, yeah, I know. It's number 46 here. It's this one. Can you see it?
Yes, I can see it. So if you, if for instance, if you play it like it's written, it was what I just did. But just show me again. I will show you. If you just take, for instance, my teacher said, okay, why don't you play only the first bar in each line? So you can fool around with it, you know, like this. Two first bars. So make your own exercises from it. And I think to challenge the kids doing this kind of things, then it's fun because it's something different which make the focus away from just being strict. And I remember, for instance, my teacher, you know, this. I remember when I was 11, 12, we were playing this exercise and he said, next week, you're going to play the whole exercise in one breath. What? It's not possible. Now I haven't played for 2 weeks, which is very rare for me, but I can try to do it. No? When I did that after 1 week, my teacher said, next time, two times. So, you know, I feel you have to have fun and you have to challenge the kids in that way. Make some challenging and make it not so, it shouldn't be too difficult. It shouldn't be too hard. It shouldn't be too serious. And that's why I like this fun. And that's why I'm doing all this thing. And it's all about been playing like a children and discipline.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Edward was very, very great. And in this part was really two important words from you. You have to be your best own teacher. You have to be the teacher by yourself. This is very, very, very important. My old teacher, Kurt Ram, said that also, if you're leaving the university, it's not important you play Haydn or Hummel. You must be your best teacher by yourself. And create your own programs, create your own ideas about music. And it was very, very helpful. And we can create a new urban program like with your ID now. It's really super. Thank you.
Thank you. But I think really the first part until, I think it's until the slurring section, the first part is the most important part in urban.
Yeah. You know the three books of Arban?
No.
No. Then I will send you some photos. It's the complete Arban book, it's the three books.
Okay.
Yeah, you know. Okay, then it's fine. Yeah. Okay. But you're talking about a nice video about you.
Well, I'm not sure if it's a nice video, but it's a nice video. And I just did some stuff just so you get an idea about the different things I'm doing. It's a 4.5 minute video, so I can play it for you and come back to you in 4.5 minutes.
Yes, and then we can start with some students from Rostock. Maybe they have some question or they want to play with your Arad Union idea. And yes. So we can. Thank you very much. Great. Well,
here is the, this is just mostly in Norwegian, unfortunately, but here it comes. ¶¶
the feeling that he is open to all new ideas, and you cannot stamp him as either a classical or a pop or a crossover artist. He's a musician.
Det styrets oppfatning at Ole Edvard Antonsen har de evner og muligheter som en forutsetning for et internasjonalt gjennombrudd.
A typical day for me would be a day where I do something else than what I did the day before, because 2 days are never alike in my life.
Den ene var en del av en turné på kontinentet. Et klassisk pop- og rockeshow kalt The Night of the Proms, som samlet til sammen 500 000 mennesker. Den andre, en seriøs klassisk konsert med Oslo-filharmonien og urfremførelse av Edvard Hagerup Bulls andre trompetkonsert.
Certainly there's no trumpet player that hasn't heard of him. What our job is to make sure that it's not just the trumpet players who hear of him, but everybody else as well.
Of course, you have to have certain categories, but as long as it's music, and I think it's very important, at least to me, to be very open-minded about all kinds of music.
This was a video we made. I'm now 58 years old. I made this collection just before turning 50, because I felt I had to stop from traveling 250 days every year for 32 years. Of course, it's dramatically changed after 12th of March this year with the COVID and things. But when I was still touring and I was 49, just before turning 50, I was stopping up for 3 months. I sat down in my home. I was still, of course, practicing and doing things, but didn't travel. So I sat down with my piece of paper. I made a plus list and a minus list. And I was thinking, what should I become when I grow up? And do I want to grow up? And what should I do with my life? Should I say I've been fortunate, I've been lucky, traveling all over the world? Should I be more at home, teaching more, be more with my family, or what should I do? So I'd spent 3 months making this list. And of course, within these 3 months, I changed from the plus to minus at some points. And my conclusion after these 3 months was, should I slow down? Should I be more at home? No. My conclusion was, now starts second half. Now it just keep going. I really go for it. But in a different way than before. So before, it was always three things which has been important for me to say yes or no to an engagement. First of all, is it artistically interesting? Then you can say yes, and you can spend a lot of time, a lot of energy, maybe even invest money into a project because it's artistically interesting. Point two, does it bring you somewhere in terms of can you harvest from it? Can you get more engagements, or can you develop so much so it's you gain something from it? And point three, economy. You should live from it. So it's always been these three things has been very important for me to say yes or no to a gig. But then in this process before I turned 50, the fourth point came in. And that has now become number one. Is it fun? Is it something you enjoy? That's where it all started. Having fun, playing like a child. You should be more curious, open-minded. So that's the most important for me now. So everything I do, I just do it because I love it. I'm not doing it because it's a job or because something else. So that has been... that was the title for my 50th birthday this year was now starts second half. That was just to go for it. And the most people I always like to go the different direction from everybody else. So it, to be honest, even though I'm playing a band instrument and I'm conducting wind bands and stuff, I hate it when everybody goes in the same direction. Same tact, because that means there's no friction, everything is, if everybody are so agree so much, then it's not exciting anymore. So I always try to make things in a different way. So for instance, most people in my age, they get a bucket list, a to-do list. That's something they want to do before they get too old or before they die or whatever. And then I decided I could make such a list, but for me, it's more interesting to restrain myself and to still be open-minded. So I made a not to-do list. I should never do that anymore, never do that. And then still be open-minded within, because what happens if you choose one direction? What happens? Yes, you go like this. So you might not see what's happening on the side. I still want to be open and just narrow a little bit rather than do it the opposite. So I didn't make a bucket list, but a not to do list. I cannot hear you.
Yeah, thank you. Very great. Again, we make America great again. So. Yeah. Hello, boys in Rostock. You have some question? You will play anything, or you won't start with your idea about Arutyunyan? Have someone to play Arutyunyan if you like to show your ideas, or what are you thinking about that?
Well, first of all, if there are some questions, that's always interesting. Mm-hmm. Or even yeah. Disagreements, that's even better.
Please. This is not a conversation, Ola, Edward and I. It's a conversation with everybody.
I have a question. when we talking about how to be our own teacher and how to achieve goals, and how do you make sure when you had that issues with your embouchure and how to bus ride, and how do you make sure that you practice in the right direction, and how do you make sure if you practice right?
Well, first of all, the most important instrument we have are the ears. And I think I will always listen to how I sound. Do I sound the way I would like to sound? You're always trying to imagine. You have an idea about sound or about the concept, how you would like to sound. Then you should really listen to how you do it when you play. And of course, especially if you're not reading the music at the same time, you can listen even better. So always try to listen. Do I sound the way I would like to sound? Does it sound right? Another thing is that the physical thing about the feeling doesn't always correspond with the result, because you can feel shit and it sounds great, and you can feel great and it sounds shit. You never know. And I think I played some of my best concerts. I played without having the good feeling. And I cannot really remember last time I played with a good feeling in my lips. It always hits like you're tired or there's something wrong, you know? So you should not be too focused on how it feels and other things. You should be listening and just do it. I remember a very great colleague, James Morrison, the Australian guy. He told me once, he just, instead of thinking too much about how to do it, just do it. And he said, for instance, his son, when he was 18, 19 years old, he was a great golf talent, you know, golf. And he asked his father, he had got some new sticks for the golf things, and he asked his father, which stick should I use on that hole, or how should I do this? And James answers, tell me, how difficult could it be? You have a stick, you have a ball, you have a hole. You take the stick, hit the ball into the hole. And I think it's very interesting, because we are very often making it much more complicated than what we need to. You know, the physical side about the feeling, about the sound, the right, all these things. Of course, there's always some things that you need to be coached in the right way. But when you know what to do, for instance, with my teacher, I remember my teacher was, you saw a little glimpse of him at the video. In the end there, he was my mentor for 30 years, and I knew exactly what he was going to say always, because he always was telling the same things. And for instance, if I was alone in a hotel room and was a little bit unsure of my physicality or at something before a concert, I think, oh, well, I have to talk to him. So I had to pick up the phone. And immediately when he answers, I answer. So I could hang up, but because I knew exactly what he was going to say.
Start to FaceTime samtale med et hus.
Sorry, that something is happening here. So I think the feeling doesn't always correspond with what you want to do. So to make sure, to be absolutely sure, you're not always absolutely sure, but you have to risk something, and you have to make your own challenging, and you have to work, have to try out different things. For instance, when I was doing this this first pop album, I wanted to play a rock tune called Honky Tonk Women by Rolling Stones. That was my first pop album, and I to do that on the trumpet is absurd. It's totally absurd. And that's why I wanted to do it, because I wanted to do something which is totally unexpected. We spent a lot of time in the studio. I spent 1 year in the studio making this album, 1 year. And I didn't want to just do it. I just wanted to, for me, if it sounded like a trumpet or how it sounded, didn't matter to me. So if you want to play, I always try to have a very clear, brilliant, nice tone. So if you play it the classical way, this theme, which is basically a guitar riff and a raw voice, it will be. Doesn't really sound very sexy. So I had to try different things to make it sound more in a different way. So I did a lot of experimenting with the instrument. And one thing, I wanted to make it more soft with a microphone close up. I tried something totally desperate. I was using my tongue instead of my underlip. I don't know if you can hear the difference in sound, but it's. And then I started putting things into the mouthpiece, and I did a lot of experimenting. But for me, it's just having fun, create something. And what I actually learned from this process of doing pop music and rock music was I could put a lot of this kind of, at least the mindness into the classical playing as well, and the timing, how to stretch, how to be more flexible musically. So that was a very long answer to your question. Sorry.
It was very helpful. Thank you very much. We have another question about mental and physical preparation before a concert.
Yeah. That was the question, or?
Yes, the question is, how do you prepare before a concert physically and mentally?
You know, we all get nervous. And what happens when you get nervous? You get very often dry in your mouth. Things feels different. Your breath is more up here rather than using your whole body. So we have to practice in that way as well. I remember my teacher told me, if you get nervous, bite yourself hard in the tongue. Either comes spit or blood. So, but of course, I think it's all about preparation. The more prepared you are, the easier things becomes when you're actually there. Of course, if I'm to play a very, very difficult piece, physically demanding piece, contemporary piece, I sometimes wake up in the middle of the night months before, and I, oh, it was only a dream. And you know, so you're building up everything in your mind, gearing up into it, and the better prepared you are, the less stress you have on the day of the concert. So, but on the day of the concert, how does it look? I know it's different from what kind of concerts you have, which orchestra you're playing it, but the optimal would be maybe to have the general rehearsal with an orchestra in the morning, then you have the afternoon free, and then you can play a concert in the evening. In that case, I divide the day into two, and I warm up in the morning. I never save, I go for it, because the first thing which happens if you try to save your lips is that you save your breath, which actually means you kill your lips instead of playing out in the hall. After the dress rehearsal, I have lunch, I go to bed. I try to sleep. Sometimes I cannot sleep, but I close my eyes. maybe try to get between 1 and 2 hours sleep in the afternoon. I wake up, have a shower, do the shaving, and prepare as if it's a new day, because every new day your lips feels different and a little bit more fresh. So I feel that I try to cheat my body to believe it's a new day. And then I could be very nervous. I go to my dressing room in the hall, and immediately when I get on my suit, or then you feel different and you warm up. Okay, feels okay. Then your stress goes down, because then it's no way back. You just go in. But of course, if your lips doesn't always feel good, then sometimes it can be very exciting. And I remember I had one experience. I think it was in Australia, in Sydney. I was playing different pieces with the Australian Chamber Orchestra in Sydney Opera Hall. And we started the whole concert with Telemann. And the first movement, of course, is a challenge when you have stress and because of the breathing and stuff. And I had a very bad day because I had some stomach problems. And before going in, I was testing, and I felt, well, I have killed my lip. I cannot play this first movement. I can play everything else, but not the first movement. So what do? You cancel? No, you can't cancel because you're not ill. But on the other hand, if you walk on stage, it's not going to be a pleasant experience for you, for the audience, or for the orchestra. Then it's better to say, sorry, it's not possible. But it takes a lot of years and experience to actually be able to do it that way. So sometimes I feel, for instance, if you feel like the lips are not functioning, it's like I try to put a picture on how it feels. You know, if you're diving into the pool from 10 meters, I just picture, you know, you go up to the 10 meters, there are 2,000 people waiting for you to do all this salto mortales, you know, diving into the pool. And then when you get up to the 10 meter, the audience is there, and you are the only one that can see there is no water in the pool. Then what do? Do you jump or do you go back? Sometimes I've jumped. It's not a pleasant experience for anyone. Of course, that can happen, but preparation is about a long-term preparation to know what you want to do. But things changes when you are stressed, under stress, or nervous. So it takes some time to make experience out of it. But you should always be nervous. So instead of seeing the nervousness as something bad, you should make it more positive. There's to learn to live with it and to make it something that you can use for some advantage rather than disadvantage.
Thank you very much.
once of the famous trumpet players was Maurice André, and Maurice also talking about that, and he was very, very, very nervous before the concert. Still, every time, and he was never without trumpet. Every time he had the trumpet in his hand, if he ate lunch, was on the table, and in the afternoon, and his wife every time said, "Don't ask Maurice about nervous. He will shaking immediately."
Exactly.
So maybe it's makes for you a little bit quiet. Nobody is without nervous. We everybody have to fighting with nervous, but it's not a sickness, nervous.
Exactly.
It's a good way to bring your music. Music without nervous is shit. I think so.
But also we have to challenge ourselves. We should not we should not try to play safe. We have to give it. And I will share a couple of other small videos with you. You've probably seen some of this before. Maybe, I don't know if I can make it here. Because if you see this movie, it's about challenging yourself. This is from because like you said, music without nervousness or without nerves or without expression, it's not music basically. But how can we do this? This is from a football game at Wembley Stadium, and this is a very important game. You maybe saw this before, but I can share it with you now. Look at this and see what is the goalkeeper going to do here. If you haven't seen it, it's very easy because it's an easy catch for the football keeper. It should be, at least. Let me just play it again. Yes, but what does he do? The people who haven't seen it before, you're up to something. He chooses to make something totally different. Let me see, am I still sharing the screen? No.
Redknapp. Goodness me, have you ever seen anything like that in your life from a goalkeeper? That is quite the most remarkable piece of goalkeeping I have ever seen.
So you understand, it's why did he do it like this? He has fun. I mean, he enjoys football. This is his life. The easy, boring thing would be just to catch it. And it's a very crucial game against England on Wembley Stadium. I like this kind of attitude.
So, Ole Edward, maybe you don't mind, then maybe someone play a little bit from the Rostock guys.
Oh, yes, sure. That's
and always good. Then you press him.
No.
No, of course not. Of course not. Yeah. Josef, if you like, you play a little bit Haydn second movement. Or it's not preparated now.
Okay, but I can talk about a little bit about the Arutyunyan, because
yes, also that.
Mikael, do you have happen to have the sheet music for, or some of you have the sheet music for Arutyunyan in your by hand somewhere?
Or Mutsumi, you can show it on the screen.
I don't have it, but someone yes.
Maybe Mutsumi can show it on the screen.
Yeah, that would be interesting.
If it's possible, Mutsumi?
I will try, but wait for a moment and please speak, Ole Edward.
We have now in Rostock.
Yes. Yeah, but I can open it. Yeah, moment, please.
We have it here, so it's okay.
We have it, Mutsumi.
Yeah, we have it.
Thank you. So,
everybody sees it? Because... Well, I was talking about the system of notation. We all know this piece very well. We have heard Dokschütze do it. We have heard many people do it. If someone would like to just play the opening for me, just the opening bars, or sing, whatever.
Who can play it in Rostock?
Or sing it. Just the opening bars.
Or singing. Yeah. It's Arsene from the Ukraine. Arsene, you will play?
He can play the whole thing later, but I just need the opening, just the opening bars.
Sure, because of question. Opening.
He is from the Ukraine, you have to know that.
Just the opening 8 bars. Okay. Okay. You all could hear what he played. Can you do it, just this opening once more? One more. Okay, and then give me the sheet music. We all know the system of notation. How in a 4-4 bar, which is the heaviest beat?
The F. Da, 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 dum, da, da, dum. The F.
Yeah, but for everybody. Yeah, we have it here. You don't have to. Okay, but for everyone. We have, without thinking about Arutyunyan, if we just take the theory, the academic way of system of notation, in a 4-4 bar, the most heavy beat is which beat?
F.
Down, yeah, no, it's not about this. It's that the first beat is always the most heavy. Then comes the third beat, then the second beat, then the fourth beat. That's easy, you know, we all know this, okay? And then if we don't play the first downbeat, then we should always think as an upbeat to the next downbeat, okay?
The third one, yeah. I just didn't think about it in that way, that it's, there is importance of the beats. I mean, the first, it's you know, obvious, but the other beats, I just never...
No, but that I just say there's nothing wrong because everybody do it this way because we have learned that everybody do it da da di da da di da da da. That means if I would rewrite this from how you play it, I would put the downbeat on the last note in the second bar. No. And also for the harmonics, you know this. It's everything is based around the F or the E flat natural. You agree? Because there's a tremolo in the orchestra. Or in the piano, it's an E flat, natural. So all the tension on the, between the notes is between the half steps. One. And then. You agree?
Yeah.
That's about the harmonics. But if we do it very theoretically, academically, how it's written, even if it's rubato, it will be one. You agree?
Yeah.
What you play, it feels like the downbeat on the third bar is like an upbeat. And it feels like the three notes in the middle of the bar, the G flat, F, and the D flat, sounds like a triplet. That's how we played it. But that's not how it's written. I don't say it's wrong. I just say, every time I pick a new piece, even if I played it before or if I didn't play it before, if I heard it many times before, I go to the system annotation and do it academically correct first. So I'm actually 100% sure I do what I would like to do and not what is a habit. You understand?
Yeah.
Because everybody plays. I will do one.
So it's. Right?
Can you try it sure. In an academic way? Exactly. And then from that comes also the harmonics. The harmonic points comes much clearer from what you do now. Because it used to be, it had to be more too much on the G flats rather than. You understand?
Yeah, so are you playing D flat and G flat, so something like positive, negative, ta-dum, ta-dum, ba-dum, ta-da-dum?
No, but not. The most important is the E flat or the F at the third bar, because if you don't, in from the theory, if you don't play the first beat, there's always the feeling or the phrasing should be like an upbeat to the next downbeat. You understand?
Yeah.
So that's what we all learned in theory. So why don't we use the theory? Because the composer has written it from how he will or she would like this to sound. Also about the harmonic points, but also about, for instance, if you like to have a downbeat or a heavy beat, maybe sometimes you need a 3/8 bar or a 7/8 bar or whatever to become, to make the right weight on the right notes. Does it make sense?
Yeah, for sure.
So what I would like you to do is just to try it and practice it in a very conservative, very strict way. I don't think too much about the phrasing, but just do it how it's written. What I do when I practice this, I would practice it so I really know what I'm doing, not just doing it one or two times or three times. I would practice it this way for a certain period, maybe 2, 3, 4 days. And then when you come back to it, it has changed your mind and your playing, and then you can be free. But first we have to see how is it notated.
Yeah, sure.
But if you would like to play Arituna, that's fine. Play it for me, please. It's great. Play it how you would like to play it. I just wanted to make a point out of the system of notation because it's so important. Even if you play Haydn or whatever, you should always see how it's written. How does it work? So the system of notation is for the composer to actually show what he or she means, and for us to understand in that sense. But here we have a recording which is so, it gives a lot of, the original recording with Dockschitzer. We hear it that way. So we all copy it rather than see what he did from how it's written.
I mean, I grew up on this recording, that's why I was trying to copy it, and for me it was actually like the reference, yeah, of the original. That's why, I mean, I was never thinking about it. I was just playing this way.
Of course, but we all do. I do. I did also. I met Doc Schütze many times, and first time I heard him, I was only 13 years. I went to Sweden to hear him play this piece. And of course, it's a reference CD, and it's a reference to everyone. But that doesn't make it right or wrong. It's his interpretation. I think we should try to find our own ways.
True.
So that's why I just wanted to make a point that this is just a very good example for something which is becoming an habit in terms of how we play it, rather than thinking about how it actually is. And I think the harmonic part is so important. So it actually also do something with the harmonics when you play it in a different way. Maybe you should just leave the opening, and I leave it to you to practice it in different ways, because that's again what I was mentioning earlier on tonight, that when I find, okay, I believe this is how it should be, but then I try it in different ways. So why not do it really, really academically correct when you practice it, and then things will change.
So not only trying to play this way. So, like you said before, just practicing really serious in this way, in an academical way.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. I try. I mean, I spend a lot of time experimenting with these kind of things, and I, for instance, some contemporary pieces. It's if it's never been played before. You can get around with a lot of things, but there still is a system of notation that you have to interpret, and you have to understand how it's written, why it's written the way. So we have to understand, and we have to read it, we have to calculate, we have to find all these academic ways around the piece before we bring our own interpretation into it, because then it's different.
I would have one question to the beginning, because I was just looking up the score in my sheet music. And yes. It says Sciroco Torchestvino. When the trumpet starts, it says Svobodno, which means free, I guess.
Yeah.
Right? And what's this Sciroco Torchestvino?
Sciroco is bright.
Right. Uh-huh. And Torchestvino is...
So genau, wir stehen feierlich.
Ah, okay, alles klar. Und wenn die Trompete reinkommt, if the trumpet comes in with Svobodno.
Free, yeah.
Yeah,
but okay. You know, it can still be free, but we still have to understand where are the basic harmonics going. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't have to be...
Cool, then now this example makes a difference. Yeah, I understood what you mean. You played it really classically, but and at the same time free.
Yes, because otherwise it sounds like it's written a different way. It sounds like a triplet, and it sounds like the last G flat is connected to the 16 notes. That's how we played it. Understand?
Yeah, got it. Thanks.
So, but this is just, again, just an example. And I said, don't say you should play it very straight, but that's how we should do it first, to understand where the harmonics go and what is actually happening from the writing, from the composer. Then you can do whatever you like. Of course, have your own ideas. But for instance, this little motif, it has to be a downbeat, because that comes all the time. Mm-hmm. this little motif comes through all these parts. And my teacher always were very good at making stories. So he, when I was a kid, you asked about how to teach kids about these things and make stories. I remember it very well because first time I played it with symphony orchestra, I was 14. And I had played it for many years already. And my teacher told me this little motif, da-da-da, da-da-da. It's like if you won, you know, do you have lotto? You know, lotto, if you win a lot of money from some kind. So it's like, this is your
golden ticket.
Lotto ticket, yes. And you can, he was describing this. If I just make a little story that he made up, you know, this whole opening is free. It's like, he's so happy. This guy has made this lotto ticket and yes, I won the big lotto. Have it here. So the whole opening is like a cadenza with this kind of lotto thing. And then comes, what should I spend the money for? Okay, I can buy a fast Ferrari, Lamborghini, whatever, Mercedes, BMW, I don't know. He always has his ticket. And then he's, well, maybe I shouldn't use all the money. So it's still there. And then it goes, so, you know, just make this story. And then, oh, sad, I spent all the money on booze and women, you know. I should have saved some money. And then whatever story you like to make. But when he told me the story, it was, okay, your fantasy starts creating pictures immediately. So, and I think that's why I wanted to, I would like to, love to hear you play more, but I'm too eager to hear my own voice. So I'm talking all the time. But also, for instance, the same thing with Haydn. Haydn Trumpet Concerto. Why? What's so different with Haydn? And how can we make that a fun piece and a beautiful musical piece rather than a contest piece? Because it becomes more and more like a contest piece and an audition piece. And I think it's one of the absolutely most fantastic pieces we have written for the trumpet originally in the classical music. And for instance, my teacher, when I started rehearsing this, he told me a story about a conversation between Anton Weidinger, who made this clef trumpet, and Haydn. And he comes with this totally new invented instrument. Before this, it's always been natural horns, you know, with the holes, and so it's always been this open notes in the Baroque music. And then all of a sudden, you have an instrument, trumpet instrument, that can play chromatic scale. It's a world sensation. The world has never, ever seen or heard it before. So Anton Weidinger go to Haydn and ask him to play, to write a piece for this instrument. And of course, Haydn gets very excited. And says, wow, fantastic. And he asks, what key is this instrument? Well, it's E flat. Okay, play an E flat scale. Can you play it? Okay, let's start with that. So of course, it's E flat. Okay, E flat scale. We make small variations just because it's only the scale is boring. But the most important is, how about the chromatics? What about the chromatics? It's a question. What about the chromatics then? And the answer? And then we should not forget it's a trumpet. So if you keep these images and stories, it's makes a lot of sense, and it's much more fun to work with the music. It's storytelling, it's moving people, it's all about bringing something out. And we should fool around with that, have fun with it, really. Don't be too nervous or too strict. Go crazy, whatever. Okay?
Thanks.
You want to play some more from Arutyunyan or something else?
Maybe someone else wants to play something. I don't know, something.
Yeah, well, you can play with you, whatever. I promise I shall not talk so much.
Thank you so much.
Pick up on this notation.
When we talk about Haydn, I would play the second movement.
Yes, perfect. Just play a few notes first and prepare. Yes, no. It sounds very nice, and of course without warming up, and it came better second time you came with the theme, and I understand the opening. But what I would like you to do, you probably play this many times.
Yes.
So you know it from memory.
Yes. Yes.
Can you just get away from the music and play it again from the start? Maybe even close your eyes.
Just without the cheat.
Sorry?
Yes.
Yeah. And just listen to how you sound more than reading the music. Okay. Can you do it once more? And you know, I'm not sure how you feel it, but for me it sounds a little bit heavy. It can be a little bit lighter. It's 6/8, and I feel it's more like a slow Siciliano. And Siciliano is a dance, so it can be a little bit lighter. And think a little bit about which notes are the most important. Good. I was just thinking, do you play? You're separating the A, the last note in the spar. Why do you do that?
I do it because I think about the dance, and when I think about the dance, I sing. Like.
Okay, but just sing it once more.
With dance? Oh.
Yes, please.
Take it, whatever. If you like to dance, that's fine. It's great. But sing it once more, what you just did. Okay, good. Can you just do this once more, sing it, and think about how would the singer do this?
La,
even a bit of that.
La 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 la.
Okay. But that's nice, very good. And now you didn't separate the last note in this first bar. You did not separate it. Did you hear it?
Yes.
And you don't have to sing it like an opera singer. I just wanted to sing it with your voice. But the way you sing it, it's more intuitive than when you play it. So I use a lot of singing when I'm practicing. Not because I have a good voice, but because you use the air and the sound in a different way. Because a singer can make sound even if they're not singing or talking. The sound is there. It's not that they don't sing like this, because so you have to keep the airflow, and you have to sing it once more.
La 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 la.
Okay. And now, can you do it less as a singer? No, you sing it once more, but less as a singer, but just sing it like a folk melody.
Like a
folk tune or folk. And a little bit faster, not so heavy.
La 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 la.
Okay. Are you sure? Are you sure about how you want to sing it?
Yes, I think so.
Can you just do it earlier? You did it a little bit more intuitively. Now you're constructing the song. Just sing it like it's natural.
Like a folk.
Just sing it, whatever.
La 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 la.
Play it. Play the same thing. Okay. I could not really hear that you were singing it the same way. For instance, the ending, you're not singing da da da. You sing da da da. But that, you should play it the same way as you sing it. Sing it once more and listen to what you do.
La la la.
Sorry, sorry. It's not la la la.
Yes. La 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 la.
Okay, so play it. Yes, for me it's a total different story. There's still one thing, and that's the second part of the first bar. You play too much on each note. You don't sing it like this. If I should exaggerate and sing it like I heard you play it, it would be da 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 da. Should be more da da da. You remember how is the accompaniment? You know what is the accompaniment?
I can no.
Just sing it.
And I think that the piano will play it by the introduction, and the trumpet repeated.
Yeah, but I mean, the accompaniment when you play, what is the orchestra doing?
I think some chords like bum, 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 bum.
Right. You're absolutely right. Hear the orchestra when you play. Bum, 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 bum. And now play it. Yes, much better, and even more dance-like. So bum 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 da 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 bum da da da. We do it once more. I still feel that it feels like you're pushing some notes with your air. Da, 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 for me, it feels like you're pushing too much instead of ba, da, 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 bum, bum, bum. Okay, that's much better. And now the last thing I would like is that you should think it more elegant in terms of your sound and the dynamic. A little bit more, not too much outspoken, if you see what I mean. Okay, if I'm not sure, it might be the connection or which brings it out. But for me, it sounds like you're playing it quite loud, and that you're pushing the notes.
Immer eine andere Direktion, andere Richtung, nicht immer ins Mikrofon reinspielen, ja.
Okay. Because it feels a little bit more like it's much better. When you go up to the last note, it's not the last note because it continues. It stopped. This is just the first part of the phrase. But when you do it slurred, it feels like you're closing. Can you imagine that you go the other way around? That you go down rather than up. Yes, and not too long last note, not too long, and continue now. Go on. The whole phrase. Okay, I think to make it more elegant, and you know, from the second part of the phrase, go to the downbeat. Okay. Still, it feels for me from the sound that you're playing a little bit too loud and too much on each note rather than getting the dance. And the first note, make sure you breathe before you start, because you start with the tongue and it should be with the air. I feel that's much, much better, really. If I should pick on one little last thing, it feels like you play. I will go. And lighten up, not. Like that much, much better. And then the second time this comes, then you have the chromatics. The second part of the second phrase. Okay, for me again, it sounds a little bit heavy and it feels like you're slowing down on each of the fast phrases. Sorry. okay, it's much better the first part. The last part was still a little bit in conflict with the system of notation. Because you're ending. That's the lightest part of the bar, just the sixth beat. No ritardando, because it's not ending there. And what I like about this is that you have the most important thing in this piece is the chromatics. First time it's no chromatic, but here. So I would stretch this, and then after the top note, lighten it up, not be aware of the timing where you land, so don't make the small notes too big. Now within the same tempo, because now you're stretching out of the tempo. And one thing is that every fast passage you have, you're always slowing down and down at the end. You're doing. And then. Like that. The last four notes. Yes, nice. Then you play. Second note is too heavy and too long. Now the last note is much too long. And now you did a big ritardando. You remember, you have an orchestra with you. You can take certain freedoms, but be aware, you have to bring your orchestra with you. You have to hear the orchestra. You have to imagine the accompaniment. You cannot play solo without playing together with other people. Again. Dum, bum, bum, bum. For me, it's not consistent. Bom, 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 dum, dum. Okay. And then when you put it together, you should always be aware of bringing it together. You know, it sounds very nice. I think just sing try to copy what you sing and listen to the accompaniment. And don't use the music. You don't need it. Okay? I like that. And then, of course, when you practice it many times, find out where to breathe, where to put your tongue, and make it like a Siciliano. Okay? Thank you.
I will. And I will look to the video which we made, and so I can have a look for what I can choose, because I think it's very much information. I have to internalize such a mass of information. It's difficult for me, and I will check this by watching the video.
Okay, wonderful. You know, it's I think this is very good example also about we're reading music more than listening to what we actually play. Do I actually sound the way I would like to play? Do I sound the way I believe I play? Because really, you didn't need the music, and you sounded so different from getting away from the sheet music, because your eyes are obstructing the ears. So really use your ears, and you have a very nice musicianship. So use it and make it easy, smile. It's a bit too complicated.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ole, Edward, we want one play more, or you like, we have some question for you again, or?
I think we should have one go warm up, and we do questions while.
Yeah.
Yes. And comment. Nice idea. And again, disagreements. If there is some, I think I like discussions, because there's no right or wrong in many ways. And.
Okay.
Any questions?
Hello, Rostock. Yeah. Arsene, Josef, Philip, you have some question? Dorian, the masterclass is for you, not for me. Okay, other ones,
also,
question?
Ich hätte eine Frage, wenn du willst.
Ja. Dann bitte frag mal, he have a question.
One more question. I would like you to talk about, you were mentioning sound, and sound as the calling card, and sound as the most important thing. Listen to what you play. I would like you to talk about sound in two different aspects. The sound, which is the objective qualities a sound should have, and what you listen for and what you do to achieve it. And second part is different sounds in trumpet, in the trumpet world, let's say Ravinsky, Leningrad Philharmonic, or let's say Berlin Philharmonic rotary trumpet, or French piston C trumpets, and how this has changed in the, I don't know, 30, 40 years you are on the stages of the world, because of the internet, and everybody hears everybody, and does it get the same more and more, or are there like sound differences in the United States, in Russia, and you understand the question. Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question, because I think it's a very interesting question, an interesting topic. But let's take the first question first. I think to have an idea about how you would like to sound. I remember when I was a kid, I tried to copy to sound like Doc Schützer, you know, a bit more vibrato. And of course, Maurice André with his very lyrical things, but with a tongue. I really liked to find that very sound. And also, listen to Doc Severinsen or Rafael Mendez with, you know, so it's about finding the different characters. How can I do it? Sometimes you have to use the tongue in the wrong way, Sometimes you have to feel the sound in a different way, the approach of the air, the airstream. So all these things, I think we should not be too afraid of experimenting with this. And I think to try to find through all these different things, you know, and for me, Chet Baker has one of the most beautiful sounds, but he doesn't have a proper sound. It's a lot of air, but he has a personality. All these guys has personality into their playing. And I think first it starts by you get an idea from hearing something you like. You try to copy that. Then you find something else to copy. And I remember I was a big fan of Maynard Ferguson. I tried to create these high notes and I messed up a lot of chops for a period, because you try to press the way to get there. But you know, to try to copy is one thing, and then you should try to put your own sound into it. And you have to really have an idea about how to sound, and then just do it instead of trying to think too much about how to do it. Because we get to analyze too much, we'll use more air, then it's all of a sudden opens up. Doesn't necessarily be like that. And I remember when I grew up I got a mouthpiece, 1¼ C from my teacher, Bach, and he opened it in the throat so much. So it's really too much air for a small kid. But it was a total different style and you had a different way of idol, or how do you say, I mean, how do you, you wanted to sound in a different way in that time, and you used it by changing equipment. But always I try to put my own personality into it and try to make my way or like a blend of all these idols I had, which I think is important in that way. The other question, yes, there's a big, big difference from 30, 40 years back and today. First of all, I think I remember when I, in the 70s and the 80s, we all listened to Chicago Symphony Orchestra, with this big, big, fat sound with Herset and Clevenger on the horn. And you know, we listened to this as students. We listened to these albums and with Mahler and Bruckner and whatever. If I listen to it today, I would say sometimes it feels like it's not natural musically. It feels like sometimes it comes, the brass comes in like boof, 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 and not the horizontal lines. And I remember, especially in the 70s, 50s, 60s, 70s, with Reiner and all, you know, Fitzreiner, all these big, great conductors, Mravinsky and Leningrad, of course, they had total different equipment, small, small mouthpieces, different horns, Russian horns, and it sounded like this. And that was the idea as well, but it sounded great. And I remember first tour I did in old Soviet. It was not Russia, it was Soviet. I met all these guys with Margolin on the trumpet and Bojanovsky, Kafelnikov, which was a younger one. Amazing guys, and it sounded fantastic on bad equipment. So they used what they had, they made it change, made the sound they had. And also in German orchestras in that time, it felt like it was a bit too round and too not so clear. Today, I think for me, in the more interesting sound is the German orchestras. Of course, Berlin, but also Bayerische Rundfunk, and you have all these great orchestras. It sounds fantastic, and I think it sounds more balanced in terms of the musicality today. What I don't always like is that the idea of the American way of playing is that the equipment should be as big as possible, and bigger the better. For me, I try to use smaller equipment and make bigger sound. I remember Doc Schitzer used Bach 7DW with a big rim and very shallow, but it sounded big, but it could also sound small. But if you have an equipment which is too big, you can never sound small. So I rather use the small equipment and expand it. And that's about how you use the air. When I was younger, there was a misunderstanding about how to achieve the high notes. Use more air. That's what people told me. But it's totally opposite. Use less air, more speed. Mm-hmm. Less air, more speed. It all has to do with the speed of the air. And that's also some... I try to sound in many different ways, and that comes also from the jazz and pop playing. So I try to use the same equipment and expand the vocabulary. When I did my first pop album, I was experimenting with the tongue and all this stuff, because I find we trumpet players in particular, but brass players, we have maybe one or two consonants and one vocal from the alphabet that we use. That's three letters from the alphabet. While the singer use, especially folk singers, pop singers, they use the whole alphabet. And I think the term crossover, which came in the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, was a very negative term, because it was opera singers trying to do more crossover pop music or musicals, and it sounded like opera. They could not change the sound. You have to change the sound, and you have to change the vocabulary. So when I was experimenting in the studio for 1 year doing this pop album, I was really able to challenge the different sounds, and I try to use more of the alphabet. For instance, sometimes I like to play so it sounds like zzz, whatever. Whatever. And in terms of dynamics, I always think that forte dynamic, that was a little bit back to the guy who played Haydn. For me, it was a little bit too outspoken. He was playing with, even through the computers and everything, I could hear from the sound that he was playing like forte character in the sound. Which for me, I think more about characters than dynamic. For me, a forte character from mezzo forte and louder is about cold air. If you take a piano character from mezzo piano and softer, I think about hot air. So if everybody take up their hand like this and do hot air, also the class in Rostock, are you there? Hot air, cold air, hot air. It's a big, big difference. And I, because I think it's more about the sound character than decibel when it comes to dynamic. If you want to play a forte as a soloist with piano, you cannot play a forte like you do when you play a Mahler symphony in an orchestra. You have to play totally different. But the character of the sound should be the same. And of course, also with the piano, if you play, you can play very soft piano with the piano accompaniment. But if you play in an orchestra, you have to get it out more. How can you make that sound piano character and louder in a big hall? Yes, by doing hot air. So I don't know if you can hear it on the computer, but here in my room, in decibel, it's the same, but the character is different. So this is also something I use a lot to experiment with the different sounds. I don't know if that answered your questions.
Yeah, this is an endless topic. So thanks. It was very nice talking about that. I think it must be enough for this Zoom conference, but I hope to talk about that again in the future.
It's much easier to in a room, of course.
Yeah, you say right words for the future. So we're talking a lot about the Rostock class. So they are far away now because they have a big screen and watch us very good, and we cannot watch them. So I repeat now my third time, I invite you for this year, if Corona makes possible, to Rostock, and we will search nice days, and maybe some members, they could hear that here in the computer, they can also visit us in Rostock, if Ole Edward and Janne Gustafsson together there. So I will organize it, I will try. And I hope to see you really there in the class in a very small room with warm and cold air. And so, and then Michael, if you like, you can stay with us also. But it's a long way from the Black Forest to Rostock, but please. And so this, I will only repeat that we not forget it, that you stay in Rostock, dear Ole Edward.
I would love to. Thank you.
If you like it, it's water, it's fish there, and nice air and nice persons, I think.
Sounds like a good place to be.
Yeah, I think so. And yeah, what you also said about the instruments, it's changed very much in the last 30 years. So I remember Barnbaum started with us in Berlin, and he brought the German instruments to Chicago Philharmonic. Yeah. And we played the contemporary music and the French operas, the Italy operas on the French trumpet, on the Perrinet valve systems. And so a lot of changing, yeah, with the brass players. And finally, the brass players in the orchestra start to play music. It's great, really, yeah. And some question more, Julie, in Danish, maybe Ole Edward can understand you.
Tusind tak. Tusind tak for et rigtig godt masterclass.
Det var hyggeligt, tak skal du have.
Ja, det samme.
Hvor er det Danmark? So,
jeg er i Berlin, faktisk.
Ja, men hvor kommer du fra oprindeligt?
Ja, fra Fyn. Fra, ja. Fyn. Faktisk fra Odense, hvor du spillede din koncert. Så.
Tak.
So.
Sorry about this.
So, everybody, some question for Ole Edward. It's not usually that he can talking with us every day.
Philipp, hattest du nicht eine Frage? Jetzt frage ich doch.
Ja, Philipp. That's Philipp.
Yes, I've got a practical question about one piece, about the Tomasi concerto. Because in the end, or actually when the cadenza begins, there's like a chromatic scale down to the A, I think, and there's missing an E, and I just wanted to know if you can tell me if it's intentional that the E is not there, or if somebody just messed up the scores.
I think it's a mess up.
Okay.
I didn't notice even when I recorded it.
Okay. Good to know. That makes it a little bit easier, I guess. So it's about this one.
Very close, please.
Plus, there's the E missing.
I think it's it must be yes. But no, once more. If you speak, then it becomes the big screen, I think. Or how do you say?
La 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 la.
Oh, sir. I think it should be chromatic.
What? I couldn't hear you.
I think it should be chromatic the whole way.
Perfect. so somebody messed up the score, I guess. Yeah, perfect. That's all I wanted to know about this piece.
If you play fast enough, nobody will hear it.
Nobody will hear it.
if there's still time, I would play. Also play a little bit, not of the Tomasi, but of something else, if it's okay.
Sure.
Okay, wait a second.
Here the E is.
Sorry?
The E is here. On the score, sorry.
Oh no, it's not this. Oh yeah, perfect. But I don't play Tomasi now.
No, but this in this score the E is in the score.
Yeah.
Well, there's an E.
Yes.
Oh yeah, yes. There is an E.
Danke, Mutsumi.
Thank you.
It's me. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, perfect.
That looks more.
Thanks, Mutsumi. Good to know. So I'd like to play the third movement of this Bach Vivaldi concerto.
Okay, wonderful.
Thank you.
maybe it was a little bit too much waiting. Sorry.
No, but can you do it from the start once more? For me, it's a very fast piece. It seems for me that you have more time than what you actually believe you have. So it feels like even if it's a fast piece, you're playing it even faster than it's. You're playing a little bit faster than you actually play, if you see what I mean.
Okay.
So take one little step back, take it calm, and play it again, and think about the character of the piece. Okay, let's do this phrase once more.
Mm-hmm.
And rather than playing too fast in a slow tempo, play slow in a fast tempo.
Okay.
And make the character lum bum 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 bum. Hear the bum bum bum. Hear the melodic line. All the small notes should not be the same. How do you say it? It shouldn't be as strong as the other. It should be more pushing a little bit more. So we have it. It sounds a little bit, how do you say, even. You can have more character. Once more.
Again?
Yes, please. Then you do the same thing once more and da 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 dum. I would make them a little bit shorter. Da 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 da. Bum 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 bim bum. And the long notes and how should I say? The fast notes should be longer.
Okay.
Can that make sense? Because then,
if
you play fast notes very fast, they don't sound. If you play fast notes long as possible within the tempo.
Okay.
But they have more character on the dot, 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 then. And that you have to do with the tongue.
Okay.
You have to be, it's a long upbeat. Bum, 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 building. I'm not sure how it's notated. Is it eight notes? Do you start with eight notes or?
16.
Da, 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 da. Is 16 notes?
Yeah.
Okay. So the 16 notes should be generally a little bit more articulated.
Okay.
Also, dum, 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 dum. So just do it once more. Just do this bum 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 bum. This part, just this part, with more articulation.
That's okay. Yeah. Sorry. Do you mean the part after da 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 bum
bum da da da? Yeah. Dum da da da.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, sorry.
Yes, and keep the length, but just more articulation.
Okay.
Yes, I like that more. And if you take do the same thing from the beginning, these notes are too loud and too long. You know, it's in Baroque music in particular. I think it's where do we divide what's an upbeat and what comes within the bar? When you have all these notes, you know, it can be bum 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 and bum 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 ele bum 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 bum. I would practice it, divide it, and try it in different ways. Or do you understand what I mean?
Yeah, I do.
I would try different ways because then you get different ideas. Because first time it all sounded the same. Yeah. But I think you have to have an idea. What's the upbeats? How should it be phrased?
Yeah.
Can you just fill around with it for a couple of minutes yourself.
Yeah.
Just practice it now.
I shall practice it now.
Yes. Just a little bit.
With you or in the room.
just try it. Pop 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 beam.
Yeah.
Just pa 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 pi stop pa 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 dum da la. Listen to me. Just do this phrase.
Okay.
Again, the same thing. Yes. Once more. But in rhythm. You know, when you divide it like this, you play the last note like it's an ending. Da, 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 da.
No. Okay.
Da, da, da. Play it how it's written, you know. D you're playing. Ba, 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 bum, ba.
Mm-hmm.
It's important. But now it's the softest note. Da, 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 da. Oh, dum, 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 da, da, da. That's how it's
okay. Yeah.
Yes. Can you play it? Half the tempo, please.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, I think, first of all, you know all the notes. You can play all the notes in the right tempo and even faster than the right tempo. So I'm not worried about that. What I'm worried about is the character of the music and about the length of the notes, the beginning of the articulation of the notes. You have to make sure you actually are in control. You are in charge. For me, it sounds like you're not in control and in charge of every note. Okay, every note should, you should have control, even though not every note sounds the same. If you see what I mean.
Okay.
You can do it. The note should be there, but you have to articulate.
Yeah.
Just experiment.
Again, in half the tempo.
Yes. And you know when you play long notes with a D, not T.
Yeah. Okay.
So all the fast notes should have a softer articulation than the other notes.
Yeah.
But the airstream is the same.
Yeah.
For me, it sounds like you're playing. Like you're blowing rather than.
Okay.
You heard the difference in a different way I'm playing it?
Yeah, I'm hearing it.
So for me, it becomes natural. I can do it in so many different ways. So it's more about making a choice. But to be able to make the choice, I have to try it in so many different ways. I have to really practice slowly, slowly, slowly.
Mm-hmm.
And everything you practice slowly, it has to swing. It has to have a rhythm. So even if you play it, swing it.
Okay.
I have to have the pulse and feel it. Okay, so it's written really clear also, but at the end, the last two bars could also be, it's up to you, hemiol or... It has to do with how you want to, to make it. It depends on the accompaniment. It might be written this way, but still it can be a hemiol. again, how is it, an upbeat? You fed up. You have to have think the phrase in different ways.
Yeah.
So I would like you to experiment with this, but practice slowly and make it swing every phrase. You should be in charge.
Yeah.
You can play all the notes. That's no problem. But also different articulation, because still now you play. For me, no character. If you want it long, fine, but have a direction.
Yeah, all right.
You don't play the downbeat, so the rest of the bar is then an upbeat.
So the rest of the bar is what?
Always, if you don't play the downbeat, yeah. the first bar, you don't play the downbeat, then the rest of the bar is an upbeat.
Ah, yeah.
Because you always have a direction from somewhere or to somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
Makes sense? But slow. I remember I was on tour with Anna-Sophie Mutter. And she played Vivaldi Four Seasons. She had already made 3 recordings of this piece and played it hundreds of times on tour. We played, and she played 25 concerts or something in Spain, Germany, with a Trondheim soloist. And she did a recording at the end of the tour. Every night you could hear outside the dressing room, 1 hour before the concert, in the break, playing all the tutti parts, even slow. Everything was slow practice.
Yeah.
Never fast. Of course, you should get wild sometimes, but you have to make sure you're in control.
Yeah, sure.
Bravo.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ole. We could learn today not only to find a way to Rome, we could find a way slowly to Rome. And
interesting part, the slow way to Rome.
And many things what you said, maybe 100% what you said today was my heart, really. I Julie, do let me a little bit behind. She said I have never depressed the students so much, but I think we have to do and to learn many things, and we have to learn that very slowly. And every time, still. That's the way. And we have to learn the alphabet, not only O, A, and E for the trumpet. The trumpet language is more colorful as everybody expect.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to learn that the solo way for the trumpet is a big difference from the orchestral way. It's possible to mix it, but sometimes we have to decide which way we want walking in our life. And you showed us a very, very nice colorful trumpet life between jazz, rock, pop, and very good classic, and even baroque music with Hemiul. And so I like it very much what you said. And so I hope really we keep in touch,
definitely,
in the next times, and we see us again on the screen, and I hope not only on screen, I hope we can watch and meet each other in which city you want, but the first I think it will be Berlin or Rostock, and you are warmly invited. And I thank you very, very much for your fantastic masterclass today. And I hope the student could learn as I. It's not sure, but I hope. Thank you very much, Ole Edward Antonsen. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Katze Mücke. I think it's a little bit Swedish, ne?
Yes.
Julie can talk. We can talk better. Yeah. Thank you for everybody. Thank you for Rostock. Thank you for your playing. And Mutsumi, thank you for much to organize everything with this accounts, with your support, with music sheets and everything what you organized. Thank you to the United States. Thank you to Peru. Thank you to Syria. Thank you to Sweden. And really thinking, thank you for Norway and for the nice, wonderful winterscape and enjoy your skiing every day. And let us talk maybe this week again a little bit by phone. I give a call for you again, Ole Edward. So we have some small organization things also to do, maybe if you like. But today we will relax. And thank you, thank you, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, all of you, for having me in this wonderful class. And for you guys who played, wonderful playing. Keep up the good work, and I hope to see you live sometime.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Mm-hmm.